Good morning. We are continuing on in our series in 1 Samuel, examining the aftermath of this great battle that had just occurred between David and Goliath. Last Sunday, under Gordon's leadership, we considered Jonathan's reaction to what he witnessed. When he saw David, when he witnessed David's dependency on God and his willingness to stand in defiance of God's enemies at all costs, to depend upon the one who can accomplish exceedingly more than what we could ever think or imagine, Jonathan's heart leapt for joy. He had found a kindred spirit, one after his own heart. He had done the same thing back in chapter 14. Jonathan stood up against Philistines in a situation of probable death for him, and the Lord delivered him. So he had found David now, a co-laborer, a partner, a covenant friend of holiness and righteous love. They committed to defend the honors of one another, serve before the Lord together. So today we're going to investigate what Saul's reaction was to the aftermath of this victory. Henry David Thoreau wrote, "The mass of men live lives of quiet desperation." And in our passage this morning, we are presented with a picture of a man who becomes increasingly desperate. His reaction to the continued success of David? Well, he chooses to live a life of not so quiet desperation, using every means available to try to take David out and to cling on to the kingship which the Lord promised to remove from him back in chapter 15. Although we are going to cover content from chapters 18, 19, and 20, let's read chapter 18 now, verses 5 to 19, to get a taste of Saul's reaction to David. Here's what the Word of God says. Whatever Saul sent David to do, David did it so successfully that Saul gave him a high rank in the army. This pleased all the people and Saul's officers as well. When the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistine, the women came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul with singing and dancing, with joy, joyful songs, and with tambourines and lutes. And they danced and they sung. They sang, "Saul has slain his thousands and David his tens of thousands." Saul was very angry. This refrain galled him. "They have credited David with tens of thousands," he thought, "but me with only 1,000. What more can he get but the kingdom?" And from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. The next day, an evil spirit from God came forcefully upon Saul. He was prophesying in his house while David was playing the harp, as he usually did. Saul had a spear in his hand, and he hurled it, saying to himself, "I'll pin David to the wall." But David eluded him twice. Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him. The Lord was with David, but had left Saul. So he sent David away from him and gave him command over 1,000 men, and David led the troops in their campaigns. In everything he did, he had success because the Lord was with him. When Saul saw how successful he was afraid of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David because he led them in their campaigns. Saul said to David, "Well, here's my older daughter, Merab. I will give her to you in marriage. Only serve me bravely and fight the battles of the Lord." For Saul said to himself, "I will not raise a hand against him. Let the Philistines do that." But David said to Saul, "Who am I and what is my family of my father's clan in Israel that I should become the king's son-in-law?" So when the time came for Merab, Saul's daughter, to be given to David, she was given in marriage to Adriel of Mehola. This is the word of God. Please be seated. Let's turn our hearts to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for the opportunity to gather together here as your people. Thank you for the children who have sung and who are going to worship you in another place at this point. Thank you that you have ordained praise from their lips. Thank you for the praise that has been sung of and spoken of already among this congregation. We indeed desire to bring you joy in all that we do. Lord, thank you for your word, encouragement that it is, and the proclamation of good news to tired and weary people that you provide through it. Lord, now we ask that you would do immeasurably more than what we think or could imagine from your word this day, in Christ's name, amen. So as I was working on this message yesterday morning, I had a terrible case of sermon block. Sermon block is sort of like writer's block, but it's worse because you know that you have in just a day a 8:30 a.m. Sunday morning deadline to become unblocked. And as I was preparing and thinking through things, a yellow jacket began to buzz around my head in the office. And I thought it was quite strange. I've never had a yellow jacket in my office. Never had a bee, certainly in late October, in my office. But there he was, buzzing around my head, and then going right in front of me, to the window in front of me, banging up against the window over and over. And the buzz, it got louder and louder, and it was trying to escape to its freedom that it could certainly, surely see out the window. But it kept running in. Bam, 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 over and over into this invisible obstacle, in its opinion, I guess, this pane of glass. So needless to say, I was quite concerned because as the yellow jacket became more frustrated, banging and buzzing more intensely, I had no desire to be a recipient of its wrathful sting. I'd not been stung by a bee in many years, and I preferred to keep that good streak of fortune intact. So I stood up, looked around my office, and I came up with a clipboard. I thought this thin and hard, quick, workable instrument of death would do the job as I smacked the bee against the glass, putting this poor raving creature out of its misery while, of course, protecting me. But then I remembered we're studying 1 Samuel, and I thought forward to 1 Samuel 24 as David resheathed his sword in a cave standing near Saul, allowing Saul to continue in his life, opening up the opportunity for him to repent from his murderous pursuit of David. And I thought, how could I How could I? So I reached forward, and I opened a window, and I sat down, and I began to write. And this may sound like all too simplistic of a metaphor for the profoundly frustrating circumstances that Saul found himself in chapter 16 and his reaction to it from there on. But nevertheless, I think that angry bee growing in its ferocity captured the picture quite well of Saul's inner person and his actions. Saul was like a vile, violent hornet who is now going to go down any path, hoping that he wouldn't go down, and employing his poisonous sting in one last ditch effort to escape. It probably is not too hard for us to identify with Saul. God made him king. He liked being king. He wanted to be king. He enjoyed ruling over all. He wanted to stay king. Samuel told him he wasn't going to be king anymore. And you could imagine putting yourself in his place. That wasn't a very easy pill to swallow. Or maybe you can approach it from a different perspective. He wanted to be loved. He wanted to be admired by everyone. He wanted to be seen as the successful one, the hero of his people. But apparently, all the eyes now were looking at David. David is getting all the attention. He's the hero beloved by the followers of Saul, who used to follow him after this victory against Goliath, as they sing about David. Well, they did sing about Saul too, but they were singing about David. And he says, what more can they take from me? What more can he get but the kingdom? Saul was facing the loss of his status as king. He was facing the loss of his stature as admired hero, and he didn't like it. He didn't like what was happening to him. And I guess most of us don't want that kind of thing to happen to us either, do we? We don't want that to happen to our lives. Not many of us hold such inordinate power in our hands as Saul did. There are some among us, I know, that are CEOs and heads of their departments and have achieved great heights in their field of study, but most of us aren't there. But no matter who we are, no matter what our life circumstances and the situations with our family and friends at work, at school, we have our own, personal kingdom that possesses status and stature for us. Kingdoms that we ferociously claim as our own, belonging to no other, that we fiercely protect at all costs. What's that for you? What's that kingdom that you do almost anything within your power to keep and to protect as your own, to guard with your life? And what extent are you willing to go to keep it? When I was a junior and senior and in high school, I was fairly successful at baseball. I ended up being the MVP as a pitcher on my team, an all-conference player, all-South Jersey player, honorable mention, all-state. And I was recruited by numerous colleges. I ended up deciding on Lafayette College. But when I walked onto the college campus and there onto the college baseball field, it all changed. I mean, it was a whole different experience. It became apparent that I was no longer the celebrated star, But now I was sort of that bottom rung bench warmer, as these like really large college muscular junior and senior pitchers who looked like they could crush a baseball in their hand were now the ones on the mound. And there were freshmen who were also the all-stars and all-states who were on my team as pitchers. And they were as good, if not better, than I was. I didn't really see it coming. And I don't know for you. Maybe you don't see it coming either. Or maybe like Saul, you see something coming down the road. And it grips you with fear, like, I don't want to lose what I have. This is my life. This is what I want. Maybe there's something or someone else, or something that someone else has that you wish you had. How do you react? What has been, what is, what will be your response to that? I know as my freshman year went on, it was admittedly a year of despair. To be honest, there were moments of jealousy, secret jealousy, hoping that the other pitchers might throw too many balls, that they'd walk too many batters, so I would have to be called on to come in and save the day. I took devilish, I would find glimmers of devilish hope for myself with other pitchers when they said, my arm's a little sore. I'm like, I'm so sorry. But inside I'm kind of leaping. This might be my chance. How does Saul react to what was unfolding before his eyes? Well, he witnessed two things with David, didn't he? He had witnessed the fact that David had the ability to bring peace to Saul where he could find no peace in himself through this gift of music. Saul would be overcome by the torment of an evil spirit, and he couldn't stop this tormenting nature that was driving his soul down. But David could, and Saul saw that. But secondly, Saul also saw David out on the battlefield, and where Saul could not stand before Goliath and defeat Goliath with his armor on, David could without armor on. Take that with the growing reputation that everybody began to say, hey, David, you're great. I love you. You're awesome. And marry that to the prophecy or the statement that Samuel made that surely Saul, the kingdom will be taken from you and given to another. Put all that together, and how do you react? Well, Saul's concern grew exponentially. How did he react to what was unfolding before his eyes? The first thing we find out in 18:2, we didn't read that, but it was impacted in the section about Jonathan. It says, from that day forward, Saul kept David with him and did not let him return to his father's house. So Saul kept David with him. In fact, it goes on to say that Saul gave him positions of leadership and authority. And from all outward appearances, this sounds great. Saul appreciated David for what he had done in defeating Goliath. And so he wanted to honor him with a position in the royal court. Yeah, that's sort of what it sounds like. But I suspect that's not what was going on. I think there was another motive in play. Ultimately, well, you get it. He just wanted to keep an eye on David. In fact, 18:9 points that out. The NIV says, and from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on him. And I'd argue that what we hear in 18:2 and 18:9 are really the same thing. This is just one whole unit driving home the same point over and over. Everyone is speaking well of David because of his victory over Goliath. Three affirmations of David occur. First, Saul's son, Jonathan, expresses his deep admiration for David in verses 1 to 4. Secondly, Saul's officials, they are stated as smitten by his excellence. They were fond of his wise and successful leadership. They spoke well of David. And then third, if it's not bad enough, all the women, all the girls are coming out and saying, Saul, you're great. David's great too. Boom, boom, boom. Affirm, affirm, affirm. And so what you see here is just this bookend that in 18:2 he says, from that day forward, Saul kept David with him and did not let him return to his father's house. And then closing that out in 18:9, it says that Saul kept a jealous eye on him from that time on. Both are saying the same thing. Saul was trying to keep David under his thumb. He tried to control David by his appointment and with his authority. It's a feigned act of honor towards David. But he does it so that David would remain under his control. Hoping, I think he was actually hoping that as he gave assignments to David, that he would actually prove unreliable or something unfortunate would happen to him as he went out into the battlefield. But to Saul's disgust, just the opposite happens. The Lord is with David, and because of that, everything David did, he succeeded at. Bam! He slammed into this invisible pane of glass. So he tries something else. While he was again tormented by an evil spirit from God, and David was in his presence playing music for him, he takes a spear and he tries to kill David. It says he tries to pin him two times. Now, clearly, if you are tormented by an evil spirit, Gordon preached on that issue before, so refer back to his previous sermon if you want to get more on that. But if you're tormented by an evil spirit, it puts you in a bad mood. I mean, it just goes without saying. But I am not convinced that the evil spirit caused Saul to try to kill David. It says in verse 11 that Saul said to him, I'll pin David. I'm sorry. It says Saul said to himself, I'll pin David to the wall. It doesn't say that the evil spirit said, Saul, pin David to the wall. It says Saul said to himself, I'll pin David to the wall. And by the way, this language of pin, the Hebrew is most often used to mean kill. Or strike down. This wasn't just, kind of giving him a warning to look out for. He was trying to kill David. But here, he was doing it on his own accord. But while under the guise of being under the influence of the evil spirit. I can imagine, after he missed, David, what are you doing? I'm so sorry, David. I was overcome by this evil spirit, and I just couldn't help myself. Will you forgive me? Well, it was all to no avail. Bam! He slams into that invisible pane of glass again. So he tries a third Trojan horse approach to dispense of David. He tries to fix David up with his daughters. Doesn't that seem awfully kind, a warm and sporting gesture? The first one, his oldest daughter, Mira, we read about. David refuses on honorable grounds that, Saul, I am not worthy even to become your son-in-law. I can't do this. And so he doesn't marry Mira. But Saul, we didn't read this, the next section says that Saul finds out that his other daughter, his younger daughter, Michal, she's attracted to David. Oh, he thinks, yes, an even greater hook. My daughter, Michal, she loves him. Says that Saul was particularly pleased with this. And so again, he offers his daughter to David, but David, like the last time, initially refuses for the same reasons. I am not worthy to become your son-in-law. So what Saul do? He sends his attendants along, his officials or servants. He says, go talk to them. And so they go and they offer flattery and sweet talk, trying to talk David. Hey, David, come on, Michal. She's so beautiful and she loves you. And Saul really thinks you're a great guy. Come on, marry her. So he finally agrees. How could he resist? But Saul's motivations are betrayed as the writer records why Saul was so eager to have David marry Michal for two reasons. First, it says that Saul says, she'll snare David. Doesn't really say why, how she's going to snare him. But it is interesting if you look back over the past several books, if you look at Exodus and Deuteronomy and Joshua and Judges, this language of snare is used in many cases in those situations. And it always has to do with the Lord warning Israel about the idolatrous practices of the nations, that if you become connected to them, you will be ensnared by their idolatry. How's that for a sweet motivation on Saul's part? Here he is. Saul knows the filthy character of his daughter, and he hopes that through being yoked to David, she would turn him down that path of idolatry, making him displeasing to the Lord. How's that for a good dad? But it's worse, because he has even more immediate plans. Hopefully that'll work out in the long run, but here's something more immediate. He knows that if David is given the status of son-in-law of the king of Israel, he would become even a fatter, huger target for the Philistine soldiers. That's David's son-in-law. That's Saul's son-in-law. Let's go after him. And so what's he do? He greases the skids. He uses David's tender conscience against him. He says to him, well, gosh, I know you don't feel worthy to be my son-in-law. But you know what, David? I'll give you a way to prove your worthiness, to earn the status and prove to yourself and to me and to everyone who observes that you truly are worthy. Just go kill 100 Philistines and bring their foreskins back to me. Prove it. Of course, since the Lord is with David, he not only kills 100 Philistines, but he doubled it. He killed 200. How's Saul feeling? Bam! he slams into that invisible pane of glass again. And so this not-so-quiet life of desperation continued. He tries another tactic. In chapters 19 and 20, two times, Saul demands his son. Goes from his daughters now to his son. He goes to Jonathan. Jonathan, kill David. In the latter chapter, he tries to shame Jonathan into action. He calls him, you are a son of a perverse and rebellious woman. Tries to shame him. Then he tries to guilt him into action. Jonathan, I know you are in allegiance with David. In other words, come on, be loyal to me. I'm your dad. Go kill him. Then he tries a third way. He tries to bait him into action, saying that if David, Jonathan, if David takes the throne, you are not going to become king. Your family will not accede onto the throne. But Jonathan responds to none of it. And he honors his friendship with David. Bam! Slammed into that invisible pane of glass again. Samuel told Saul in chapter 15 that the kingdom would be torn from him. And from that point on, he had his antenna up, afraid of what might come. He was on the verge of losing his kingship and kingdom. And how did he react? Well, in the most awful, treacherous, manipulative, deceitful manners one could dream up. He feigns honoring David with positions of authority so that he might do everything he can to control him, to hold him down, while hoping all along that in some way David might fail or that he might fall to the hands of his enemies. He takes advantage of a moment in which David is ministering to him and caring for him, trying to kill him with his own hands, taking a spear and throwing it at him. And presumably, I'm sure he said, oh, David, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to do that. The devil made me do that. He takes the holy institution of marriage and the daughters that he is to love as a good father. He should cherish and love them. And he uses that institution as an instrument of assassination. He thinks so lowly of his daughter that he hopes her moral filth in and of itself might bring an end to David. But if not, he eggs David on in his love for David. He eggs his daughter on for his love, her love for David. Come on, go ahead, marry him. It's a good idea. But what's he hope to happen? As soon as they get married or before, he hopes that David is murdered. How's that for a thoughtful and kind and loving dad? And so then he tries to verbally manipulate his son Jonathan, trying to turn him around against David through shame and guilt and greed. And I can only imagine that if Jonathan had turned on David and successfully murdered him, can't you see Saul just at the end of it washing his hands? Oh, I didn't do that. That's my greedy son who killed David. He's the one who didn't want to lose his chance to become king. And then finally, he just drops all pretenses as the sordid narrative continues to unfold. He sends soldiers out to kill David, and he himself attempts to track David down and to pursue him, continuing in his murderous ways, trying to maintain his status and stature, becoming completely unhinged, clearly living a not so quiet life of desperation. bam, 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 over and over, he runs into this invisible pane of glass, frustrated, thwarted, and striking out with deadly intention. And you know, I'm really afraid to ask this, but I think I must. Is that you? Are you like that? Are you Saul? Does the spirit of Saul live in you? It's sort of a gut-wrenching thought to entertain. You don't even want to think about it. Do I wish ill of another for my personal gain? Am I involved in character assassination? Am I manipulating my family, my children, my wife, to try to get what I want? Am I using coworkers to sow discord in my workplace that I might benefit? To what extent will you go to hold on to what you think belongs to you, or to get something that someone else has that you wish you had? Do you praise others to their face only to curse them behind their back? Do you raise your fist in anger to God for the life that he's thrust upon you, or that which he's taken from you? At almost every step, Saul could hide, couldn't he? He could hide it from everybody else, what his motives and thoughts were. And I wouldn't be surprised if you asked him if he even got it himself. Look, I had every intention of blessing David. That's why I gave him a position of prominence right next to me. I think he's great. I would love to have him as my son-in-law. I'm so happy that my daughter loves him. I can't wait until he comes back from knocking off those Philistines. I know he can do it. Oh, I'm sorry. I can't seem to control myself when this evil spirit comes on me. Please forgive me for my ungrateful actions. Can I have my spear back? Is that you? It is living out a not-so-quiet life of desperation, isn't it? And the more you act out, the more you're stymied like an aggravated bee ramming over and over into an invisible window pane. And what did it get Saul? As history records, the kingdom Saul ruled over, it's handed to David. Jonathan, his son, is killed. Saul's other sons are killed. Five children of Saul's first daughter, Merab, are hung. His other daughter, Michael, she dies bitter and barren. And of course, Saul gives the order to his armor bearer to kill him when he becomes wounded on a battlefield. And the armor bearer won't do it. So he kills himself. What do you hope your iron grip might secure for you? What do you hope those subtle schemes and traps might achieve for you? And you gotta wonder, did it have to be this way? Did this have to happen to Saul? Did it have to end this way? Was there no escape to this tragedy? Well, yes and no. From chapter 15 on, it was clear Saul was going to lose his kingdom and kingship. Samuel states, "The Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you and has given it to one of your neighbors, somebody better than you. He who is the glory of Israel does not lie or change his mind, for he is not a man that he should change his mind." Yes, it was crystal clear. Saul was going to lose his kingdom, the kingdom that he loved, because of his unfaithfulness. It had to be that way. And it was equally clear as the chapters unfolded that the kingdom was going to be given to David to rule over as king. But all that other stuff, there is no statement made by Samuel about what would happen to Saul and his family, that his family would suffer or be put to death. In fact, if you think about it from every conceivable angle, we can only see the Lord extending a merciful hand towards Saul. And I wish I had enough time to unpack it all, but suffice it to say that every time Saul tried to take matters into his own hand and pull the rug out from under David, he was thwarted. Everything that Saul tried, he tried to do it at least twice. He tried throwing his spear at David more than two times and was unsuccessful at hitting David at such close range. He tried to fix up not one of his daughters, but two of his daughters with David as a means of leading David to his death. He couldn't convince David to marry Merab, and he eventually convinced him to marry Michal, but his deadly scheme failed to materialize. He tries to enlist Jonathan two times to kill David. Both times, he refuses. He sends multiple teams of assassins after David, but they do not fall. David does not fall. They fail. And then he personally goes after David several times, and he fails. Bam, bam, bam. Into the pane of glass. But these were not simply acts of blessing and protection upon David. These were acts of mercy. These were second chances upon second chances for Saul to wake up. Come on, see what you're doing. Stop what you're doing. Come to your senses, Saul. Aren't you surprised at the depth of depravity that you have sunk? But it wasn't just these second chances. All around Saul, the testimony of the goodness of David was spoken. The people spoke well of him. His officials spoke well of him. The women sang of him. His own son spoke highly of David and tried to convince him to give up seeking harm to David. Come on, Dad, come to your senses. He is a good man. Honor him. Give this up. Oh, if only Saul would open his eyes and see him in this light. But Jonathan goes above and beyond counsel. He offers his example. Jonathan, you know, he shows the appropriate response to what Saul should do towards David. He shows no reluctance of removing his princely garments and handing them over to David. This too, here's an evidence of the hand of mercy extended to Saul, wooing him, "Release your grip, Saul. Give up control for your own good and the good of your people, the good of your family." Oh, if only in this ironic case would the father listen to the counsel of the son. If the father would follow the example of the son. But most of all, the greatest act of mercy that was extended to Saul was the gift of David himself. David comes with no pretension. He comes in complete humility. He didn't come to seek the throne. He came to serve and not to be served. You know, that whole evil spirit thing. Yeah, that seems really strange from the first glance that God would send an evil spirit to torment Saul. But what an act of mercy it was. For these episodes paved the way for the only one who could truly bring relief to Saul. The one who is now filled by the Spirit of God and who had control over this evil spirits to send them nigh, who could bring peace and hope and strength back into the heart of Saul. I can only imagine what joy it brought David to play that music and to see the relief that it brought to Saul. By the power of the Spirit, David was the only one who could save the people of Israel. And by extension, save who? Save Saul himself from the merciless attack of the great Philistine Goliath. Indeed, in every way imaginable, David was not only the good king and savior of his people during his days on earth, but he was the good king and savior of Saul. He lifted not a hand to strike against Saul for his rabid hatred or his insolence. But time and time again, David sought peace with him, extending mercy to him. Oh, if only Saul would have repented and welcomed David and let go of his deathly grip of that which no longer belonged to him. What abundant blessing, what abundant life would have been granted to Saul and his family. I mean, isn't it ironic that the only one who could defend Saul and bring peace to him personally was the one he rejected, the one that he sought to murder? I mean, do you not see? The window has been opened to Saul, to freedom and life. The very one he feared would end his life was the very one, the only one, who could provide and protect and to bring him peace and to bring him life. Now, I don't know where life is for you. I don't know how you feel about things in your kingdom right now. I don't know if you are where you are because you've made some bad choices that led to a bad place for you, like Saul. I don't know, maybe bad things have happened to you, and they seem like they happened for no apparent reason. Not because you were sinful. In fact, you've been living a good and righteous life before God, and things have happened to you to lead you to a bad place, like Job. You might be living a very quiet life of desperation. You might be living a life that's not so quiet. A not so quiet life of desperation. Whatever the case is, you must not turn from God. You must not turn on God. You must not be angry with God. You must not shake a fist at him and take matters into your own hand, for he is not your enemy. He is your Savior. Christ has come as the Son of David, the man who possesses God's own heart. He's come with no pretension, claiming no rights. He has come to serve and not to be served. He's come to defend you and to lay down his life for you. He's come to open a window for you to freedom and life. Christ is the one filled with the Spirit, who has authority over the powers of darkness, whether spiritual or material, and he comes gently to you. He honors who you are. He helps you. He seeks out your good. He is not your enemy. He is your Savior. Oh, yeah, you have got to lay your garments of personal authority before him as Jonathan did. You've got to give up your right to your kingdom. Jesus says, whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, for me, will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world but lose his very self? You know, the funny thing is that as soon as I put my clipboard down and went over to the window and opened it up, the bee flew in the opposite direction. It flew up into one of the light fixtures. And I never saw it again all day this morning. I am pretty sure it never went through the window I had opened for it.